They're all here. David, they're all here. Don't pet them.
He already has.
Oh, they have that.
What?
Diarrhea?
Tick.
Oh, well.
A lot of tick.
Look at that.
Okay, everybody. We've got it to ourselves, so let's take about less than 10 minutes, but more than 5. Because if you go through and see, your eye will tell you what interests you. And if I take you through to show you what interests me, that's all you'll see. So take as much time as you need, but between 5 and 10 minutes to wander through. What's with the guy? No?
I didn't talk to him yet.
Go in.
He's here. I will talk to him. Okay. And then we meet in the first room.
Meet in the first
in
room
a bit.
Here or out here. Okay. If I go with you, you'll all ask me questions. So.
I have a question. Can we take one more?
What? Probably take 8 or 10 of them.
Can we start with our questions?
Fine.
Can I make a question right away?
Yeah, you can.
This is the right altitude? I mean, this used to be covered by something?
Yes, yeah. They're pretty good at that sort of thing, of figuring out where it was. I mean, all of, behind you, all of that is restoration. The bottom registers are intact. You know, that was found. And they've got enough of it, you know, when they excavated first, there's enough so that they can be pretty sure where, how high they would have gone. So all of this, it would have been seams here from the bottom registers here all the way to the top. In certain cases, there's enough left over. I mean, there are enough things so that they can probably correctly place them. So sometimes you'll see a wall with just a couple here and one, two there and so on, because there's a kind of a pattern. In many of the tombs, they start out with on the exterior, on the first, the entry to the tomb will have one of these elaborate scenes, and sometimes many registers and much more, not more complicated than this, but other aspects of it on the entrance and what they're showing you here. So now this is a perfect example of a scene from daily life that's much more than a scene from daily life. You have here, and if you look closely, you see it's all composite, it's all jumbled together. It isn't what you see is what you get, but it's not necessarily that they're doing all of these things simultaneously in real life. Here you have, this is the papyrus swamp, all of those stalks, like a rainforest. And here you have there are various plants. We'll see more of them inside. That's a bulrush, and with a little frog sitting on the end, and a butterfly at the other end. So all of those will be accurate. Over here, you have guys fishing. You see they've got a big net here where they're catching fish. Down below, this is all underwater. And here you have the various fish. If you really know your fish, you know what each of these fish is. That's a catfish. I don't know what the devil that.
Tilapia?
Maybe. And with the lotus in between, I just noticed that. I've never noticed that before. But you see all of these other scenes here that are much more than just daily life. This is probably what you see is what you get. This is a hippo over here. She's actually giving birth to a little baby that is being eaten by a crocodile. And this is, you know, set of cartoon form. Elsewhere we'll see even more dramatic instances of it. The mama hippo is grabbing the crocodile and crushing the crocodile between its gigantic jaws. So this is probably, really is a scene from daily life, but it has a deeper significance, a cosmological and astronomical significance. Elsewhere, I probably pointed out, I mean, we're in the tombs at the Valley of the Kings, And there are, you see the hippopotamus in the starry ceiling, standing there with a stick like this, the pregnant hippopotamus upright with her breasts, you know, standing sort of half human, half hippo, where she represents the principle, cosmic principle of pregnancy, of birth, which is associated with the goddess of pregnancy. But, and the crocodile, of course, represents death. And you see, I think we did see one, at least one, where the crocodile, the hippo is standing, Tauret, the crocodile, is standing, and she's got a crocodile on her back. So they represent, in fact, the axis of the created universe, where the crocodile represents fertilization, gestation, and birth, and the...
No, the hippo does.
Sorry, the hippo represents everything associated with birth and maternity, and the crocodile death, and so when they're fused together, they are the principle of becoming and return, and so are placed at the very axis of the universe itself. So here's the counterpart on, you know, as above, so below, literally, as above, so below, and here we see it in action. And I was just saying before how complex these are, but there are millions of things that you can spend a lot of time with. If you know your fish, which I don't, you could probably determine why those fish are placed where they are for some reason or another. Over here, interesting, you see here too, but here you see the whole thing. You see these, this has a lot of significance, believe it or not, in terms of development of civilization. You see, this little skiff here, rowboat, is made of papyrus reeds, but the identical skiff is used in Lake Titicaca by the locals there. So, yeah, if you have it, but there it's a different reed, a different kind of reed. But, yeah, if you're going to build a little boat of some sort out of reeds, you certainly come up with something maybe similar, but to come up with exactly the same, that's a stretch. So it's hard to avoid the diffusionist point that it's, or better yet, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, the one civilization that breaks down, leaving pockets of itself wherever they find, you know, a safe haven and take root, and they carry with them the knowledge that they had much, much, much earlier, before. Over here, let's see what he sees up in the paddles.
Smoke eel right there.
Where is it there?
An eel.
Oh yeah, river eel. Well, sure. Well, it's not that smoky. Okay. Let's
The quality of the art here is kind of like it has a certain quality to it, a special one.
Good point. Yeah.
Organic.
You see in a couple of the other tomes that this has a kind of an Art Nouveau look to it, really, or the rounded forms and so on. That's not typical. Usually they're more clear cut. So for whatever reason, Kagemni, who is, I think, a vizier, which is a prime minister.
Of Teti. That's the cartouche of the king who he was.
Teti. So it's 6th dynasty?
Yes.
This one? Medinaca 2. Yeah, and Talatep is 5th dynasty.
Yeah. And these are his titles and name. Huh? Teti, he was the servant or the high priest of Teti, and he was a scribe. Look, that's the ink pot. And that's his name, Kagemni, right? So, and those tombs are like condos, one room, corridor.
John,
and
yes. My question initially was up here. What was up here?
Roof.
Oh, there would have been a roof.
Stone.
There would have been a, are you sure, stone roof?
Stone, of course, and stone. When they excavate, these are places mounded with sand, so they drill and they... Most of the roofs have been gone. We're going to see in Ptahhotep. Ptahhotep's roof is a good example. And here too, there are some roofs.
They wouldn't know They probably originally would not have been a window there.
Right.
Yes.
It would have all been roofed over. You're not supposed to come in the tombs. You know.
These are built like little, you know, built during the lifetime of the vizier who's serving a king. The closer, the higher rank. And so they make them during the lifetime, and when they die, they stop.
Oh, and by the way, Carlos, here, you see, there's enough remaining here. The actual doorway goes up to here, so it doesn't take a lot from there to, you know, to figure out where the original should have been. We'll probably see some, if we're looking for it, we'll probably see some.
There is more.
John, is it maybe significant that hippos kill more people than crocodiles in general?
There are. And
well, they always have.
Masculine, male ones do.
Yeah.
Females are the opposite. It's life, where male is destruction. Females are the pregnant, the gestation, the baby. It's life, where the male isn't, like normal.
No. Okay. Now, in here, if anyone takes up the effacement challenge and does a study of the self-effacing Egyptians, there are a couple of different kinds of effacement to take into account, and one of them is illustrated here. Here, this has nothing to do with the priests deciding which, what's to, you know, what's had it, what's lived out its day, and what's to come. In other words, a process of decommissioning. Here, somebody is actually taking revenge on someone. You see, here the dancers have been effaced, but the musicians who are clapping time have been effaced, and the dancers are doing their backflips here, and they're okay. Nobody bothering them. And here, Kadyemni himself, for some reason, presumably it's Kadyemni, has been carefully effaced. For sure, that's not the Egyptian priests themselves doing it. Somebody's after somebody, you know, in the afterlife, as it were, getting even. And we'll see this repeated throughout this tomb. Very interesting. Why? I don't know. Interesting study for somebody. Now here we have
the most exquisite, plain, not colored.
Fishing scenes. Yeah, it would have been colored.
This one?
For sure.
Okay.
For sure. That would see just some left there.
Tight.
Yeah, all of this would have been colored, absolutely certainly. And here, this is where I was saying that on the basis of this, you could reconstitute a whole fishing, you know, a Nile fishing industry. Look at what they're using, the gang hooks here. Even the rope, look at the detail of the rope, which is absolutely incredible. And the way that they're paddling. What's he got here? Mm. Here he's poling along, actually. He's pushing the boat. Yeah, he's poling. He's poling along with it, you know, just like this. Mm. Punting, they call that in England. And here you always wondered how crocodiles do it, and now you know. Somebody asked you in the street.
And look at the frog. What is that
Dragonfly.
Called?
Dragonfly. Dragonflies and frogs. And this is where, okay, here, see, there's a little bit of text here. Well, we don't have the rest of it, but you can be sure that the reason there's a dragonfly and a frog here, there's some reason for it, there's grasshoppers. Almost certainly it is not just the caprice of the artist saying, well, let's put a dragonfly there. Mm-hmm. It has something to do with a story. Here's more crocodiles and hippos, very, very clumsily wrought here, strangely enough, whereas in the other room they're really very elegant. And the way that they're doing...
His toe, he's harpooning in front.
Yeah.
On the skiff. Mm-hmm. So on the river night.
And here's the... Okay, here, perfect. Crocodile,
hippo.
Crocodile being, you know, crushed. Snout of the crocodile being crushed by the hippo. And here, papyrus swamp.
Look how beautiful it is. You realize it's triangular. The stems. Yes,
even so carefully realized.
Beautiful.
The papyrus grows like this.
In a triangle.
Not just a triangle, but a a curved triangle, and they reproduce that here.
Yeah, it's full.
Really elegant. And here, now over here, these they're harpooning the male crocodile because they are the animals of Set. And here we have, this is St. George and the dragon, you know, back in the old kingdom. Here, I don't know what they're bashing. But you see, again, the detail of the ropes. Here, more fish. Here, papyrus skips have been getting beautifully wrought.
It looks like he's surfing. Hmm? It looks like he's surfing on this boat.
Yes, he's harpooning. And that's his wife, Kagimni's wife. Look at this kind of like pond. So he's kind of like fishing here, you know?
Here, I'm not sure what they're doing here. Making something. Oh, here are the hunting dogs. And by the way, I usually manage to forget this, but I remembered this time. Hold a second, Sahila. I actually remembered the change. Two. To show you. That's a good sound.
Well, there are some others.
There are others that are hunting.
You need the pointer?
No.
No, I'm looking at them.
He's kissing the people.
Yeah, wait a second. So I'll get into that in a second, too. Here. Because it was the dogs, actually, when I first went to Ibiza, and I read. And I did a little bit of due diligence. Somebody told me about this wonderful place, and I just had my first story published. And I really didn't know how to do research in those days. So I just looked in the Encyclopedia Britannica for Ibiza, and there was a little paragraph, and in the paragraph it said, there's a breed of indigenous dogs that are said to be descendants of the ancient Egyptian hunting dogs. And I've always had a thing about dogs. So, that was one of the things that said, oh, well, I'll go take a look at those dogs. And sure enough, they were what the third world curs that you have around here, and these are the wild dogs that nobody was taking care of, with those. And I took them off the island and had them all along. And there's the latest one, who just died.
Sabu the second.
That was Sabu the second. See him? That's them.
Look.
Years and years, you know, yeah. 5,000 years later, they stayed pure on Ibiza, and I was one of the first ones to take them off the island. And now they're a recognized breed, but still very, very rare. And they're great dogs. You own these dogs, you don't want to have any other dogs, but you need lots of room for them to run, and they're very, very easy to live with. Unless you're a rabbit, then different. And they're great dogs. So. Good. Now here, yeah, now I always wondered, okay, these guys, this guy seems to be kissing a pig. Somebody else seems to be pouring water on the pig. And it was like, you know, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Is this possible? On a couple of trips ago, I don't know, it might have been when you were on, Carlos, I'm not sure. There was a guy whose family owned a sheep farm in Scotland. And they said that sometimes, or fairly often, lambs were born, they couldn't take their first breath. And in fact, they would do that mouth to mouth in order to get the lungs pumping. And it was, you know, it was commonplace on their sheep farm. So I take that as more expert advice that I could give.
Well, even if that jug is water, pouring cold water,
well,
something
gives
the
could be
response.
Well, also maybe in conjunction with that, something of the sort. But otherwise, you know, it doesn't look like anybody's favorite daily activity, I wouldn't have thought.
I don't want my dog's litter mates to breathe life into it.
Yeah?
One of Una's litter mates. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, really? Oh, well. So, there you go.
John, this one.
Oh, yes. Here they're hammering papyrus into mattresses. So, here you have, if you wanted to start all over from scratch, you'd know how to fashion your paddles.
This one I want to say. This one.
Which one? This one. Go ahead.
In order to make the cattle come across the water, they really fear the crocodiles. So they have to have the leader bring them and they follow. In order to make the leader come in and rush into the water without thinking, he's having the baby of the mother. So she's crossing, look at her eyes, very excited, and baby, and the father, come on in. So they cross the river. Huh? And look at this scene with the baby tied to the mother.
Bobbled.
So, and it's nursing, and this one milking the cow here.
Again, hobbled, so she can't, as they say, kick the bucket. So all of these things, this is, you know, fording the great river, and this comes filtering down into possibly even something to do like the sacrifice of Abraham, where you have to be willing to sacrifice your young in order to get to your higher
place. Beautiful sandals to Kagimi right there. Very nice sandals. And behind, who's this? Behind Frank, there is a really very well realized, so detailed cargo boat, loaded like no one. See? Very beautiful boats, really. With grain and with animals, and it's really beautifully realized. So intricate detail.
These aren't cows as we know them. I mean,
yes, they are.
But why do the mother heifers have steer horns on them?
They do. So you look at them, you see them here sometimes. I mean, see Hathor. Hathor is female, and she has. Don't Texas longhorns have horns? The females? Don't the cows have horns?
Not like the bulls.
There are others.
But they have horns.
Some small amount.
Really? Well, I don't know. But generally,
we'll stop photo.
There are some strangers.
Can't be like this. Well,
sometimes they get knocked off too.
I try to convince them.
But that's a good point.
What if they're other animals? Tails don't look like cow
tails either.
And
there are plenty of them.
Yeah, they do.
They look like
cow tails.
Quite a
bit longer, huh?
Yeah,
maybe.
Maybe three times the size. But it could be that the females don't look like these two here.
They don't.
The mother, the father, and then the children. The first one could be female, the rest female.
Are we sure they're the same animal?
No.
I don't know. They look the same head. Same head. Well, that's another good study. That's for somebody else to do, not me, but there it is. No, seriously, that's a good point. You know, go into the literature and check it out. Now here is, but we'll see a better one yet. Here's our bird netting scene in the, you know, in the swamps. Except here it is actually with the, it's shown in rather peculiar perspective here. Because these are the guys who should be lying down in the swamp, right, with the net spread. And here's the guy who is waiting for the decoys, and the decoys are attracting all kinds of wild birds. And this guy is in front, because all of the others are concealed in the marshes, not to scare the birds away. And he's got a long scarf, and he's going like this, as a signal that to pull the net shut and get the birds. And until recently, when the swamps have all disappeared, they were hunting. And they were, you know, they were trapping birds in this fashion. We'll see that one.
Also, it's very nice here to show the cage full of birds, and look how much they are feeding them. This is, you see, how much they are pouring lots of food and fattening. Even here, they're kind of like force feeding the birds. for maybe
Voie gras.
On the other side, you see a great deal of fishing. Wonderful. Huge fishes too. You know? A lot of fishing and the mysterious arm posture that who knows. Yeah. But then here, over here, John, right up there, you see the force feeding of the hyena.
Oh yeah, there. Yeah, that's a very the best of these is in Meredugo we hook up. What purpose the hyena serves, I have absolutely no idea. Pet hyena is nobody's favorite idea. But it serves some purpose, and here they are, presumably force feeding it or medicating it. And there's a whole, this is a whole big veterinary scene. They're doing something or another with the cattle there. Again, more, this is veterinary in some way, shape, or form. But again, part of the bigger study, why is this particular scene in many of the tombs, and what the devil are they doing? I've never seen anything really adequate about it, but again, a bit of research nowadays, especially with the internet available, and you find out stuff that things that up until a couple of decades ago, you'd have to go to the a major Egyptological library and research for 2 days to try and figure out any one of these things, and now you could theoretically pretty much have it at your fingertips.
The birds in here with their different movements and necks and round, look at them. It's like a beautiful portrait of different postures and gestures and movements of the birds. They sound to me. It's very much as if it has some musical hint.
Maybe.
Here is Meruka, of course.
And here there's a scribe writing,
writing
the results of whatever the devil it is.
Maybe it's an inventory, it's like listing how many or whatever.
But here they're doing, it's in other words, it's like a report.
His hands are backwards.
Yes, sometimes you see that.
Both of them.
That's right. Sometimes here, this one is.
Looks,
this one correct? Wait.
It looks twisted,
but I know, and you can see one nipple.
If it was twisted, his thumb would be pointing the other way.
That's so right. Backwards. And look at the detail here.
Yeah.
Look at the physical detail of the realization of the fingernails and the flex of the fingers. And you see here, he's got this scepter. It's called Sekhem, meaning power. Sekhemet, the goddess, is female, feminine power. Here he's got the Sekhem behind him. On this opposite scene here, not here. Sometimes you'll see him with the Sekhem in front of him. I'm sure we have that here somewhere.
His other hand is backwards too.
Yeah.
Both his feet are right.
Yeah, so often they have two left hand or two right hand.
This is right and left on the wrong side.
Both wrong side, yeah.
Weird.
It's certainly not that the guy mixed up right and left. He's just causing to have us leave.
It's like it would be his back is facing us.
Right, yeah.
His back was facing us.
Yeah, but wasn't
his belly button's there.
Where's the jacket?
Who's got my jacket? Oh, you're
not here.
Okay. Now, here's more for the...
Everyone?
More for the hypothesis, the self-effacing Egyptian hypothesis. Mm-hmm. Here you have these guys. What exactly they're doing, I don't know. But there's somebody has effaced the first one. And we'll see that throughout this tomb. Sometimes the first two. Some reason why somebody did that specifically.
Maybe when you switch this off, so you kill the whole line behind you. This is offerings to be brought to Kagemi's tomb. Receiving that.
Maybe, but it's certainly deliberate, and it's a pattern in this tomb, and it would be really interesting to figure it out.
Let's go.
Oh, care to. You're right behind you.
Yeah.
Again, the same. Carefully done, the first one.
Sometimes the second.
But...
And here his hands are the right way.
Yeah, they know what they're doing.
Right across from another one.
This is Kagemi wearing the cheetah. Look at the head of the cheetah and the skin of the cheetah. Because
probably the same lesson that they have in Central America among the Indian tribes there, that killing the jaguar is a, you know, single-handed is the test of the initiation into manhood. Wouldn't surprise me if something of that sort is symbolized at least here, whether or not they had cheetahs to
break, please,
to hunt, whether or not they had cheetahs to hunt in Old Kingdom Egypt, you know, running around wild. I doubt they'd have to go to Africa to get them. Oh, but here's an instance of the second in front.
And here in the back.
And here behind.
Yes, the cheetah here. Or in Egypt, when they wear this, it's a high priest costume. Yeah. So he reached this level. Mm-hmm. Among other titles he had and he carried, he was the high scribe of Teti, vizier, and high priest.
You see, he has a little short beard. The king has a straight beard. The king has an artificial one,
but this one is growing here.
The curved beard, and he has a little short one. So that's one of the attributes of a high level of achievement. Anyway. This is the, what Sahira called, the Hall of the Baskets. All kinds of elaborate straw baskets here that they should, if they had any sense, be reproducing today to sell to the grotto, but they don't. They only have one or two different kinds of baskets. And here they're bringing all the offerings in. That is the so-called false door that supposedly, standard story, the disembodied soul can go through that and then wander around the outside world at will, enjoy himself, and then come back in. I'm pretty sure it's a lot more than that, but I'm not sure exactly what.
Was that a pool of water in front of it?
No.
No, that was an offering table.
Always against the door, there is an offering table, and usually they have Hotep. A hieroglyph stands for peace.
Well, a accomplishment. They always say for peace, but really it's transformation. It's final accomplishment.
Yeah.
My pal Rupert Sheldrake assures me that with the right illegal substance in you, you too can go right through that door. So, Carlos, you want to try that one of these days?
Maybe I will.
On the next trip, come in here, because I can't afford to do this, because I suddenly might not be around to talk all this blabber.
By the way, the color you see in this detail, which is one of the finest of all art line compared to what we saw together, is about 2400 BC.
And again, if you use solvent on it, it would come right back to look as new. It's not that it's just dirty, not weathered. And here again, here is the sun's second guide.
Oh no, actually, I don't know. He's number four.
Something very interesting here. Okay.
Let's squeeze into this little baby room.
This is a favorite room.
Yeah, very special. Halwa.
John.
What?
He gave us the thumbs up to go ahead and...
Who did?
Photograph.
No, good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now, you know, in the story of Alibaba, and the 40 thieves, right? And they hide they're hidden away in oil jars, and you always think, if you think about it, that must be a pretty small thief, or a very large jar that's going to be thief size. But there they are. You could hide the thief of your choice in one of those oil jars, which I think are pretty cool.
To slide them in.
I'd like to have a few of those floating.
Very nice. Yeah.
Nice.
And thieves in the jewelry room.
Yeah, all of
match.
All of this
look
stuff
at
is
boxes.
Our offering, the boxes of jewelry. And
here, like this one, see, this necklace and other necklaces.
Sometimes they say
here there is another necklace, so this is, these are boxes full of jewelry, and look at the beautiful designs of the amphoras and sacred special oils. Mm-hmm. Actually, some oils, since they were more meaningful and more precious and rare than jewelry, like when they broke into Tutankhamun tomb first in the ancient days, they took the sacred oils and they left all. So for a second time they went, they took some jewelry. But
and here?
You think it was medicinal?
It was a lot of meaning.
Who knows?
Medicinal.
Here's another one. See, the first, second guy here.
Yeah.
So this is, I'm fascinated by this.
Look at the beautiful Kabirni standing here with his titles and everything. This side is intact, while this side has been, I think, exposed most to the sun. So it's faded. Huh?
Yeah. For the sand.
This room had a door, and until this moment, we can see the hinge. It's the wooden hinge of 2400 BC.
Yeah.
You can touch some organic 2400 BC door. Yeah?
Okay.
Let's go.
The framework that goes like, it goes like this, and then down, and that's what the profiles of the tombs were like. Sort of
with like, the, houses.
Hmm?
Like houses.
Like
houses.
Well, no, because in other words, the top was curved like this, like a bench, and then the edges were vertical, but the roofs got covered over, looking like that. So that's
okay.
Called mastabas.
Okay.
Okay, everybody.
Okay, now this
standing tree, not
low ridge. Now low ridge coming up, and you take my advice now at your peril. When you go through these low ridge places, if you keep your hand up in front of your forehead, you can use all of the space. And if you don't have your head there, make one mistake, you know that you've hit. That you hit
just hard stones.
Peter. Gonzalez coming around the toe.
This one's easy for my love. The other is not. Tombs of the fifth and sixth dynasty pharaohs. According to Jeremy Nadler, and his very impressive book, shamanic wisdom of the pyramid texts, even these were not meant to be tombs, and that the pharaohs were not in fact buried in them, says Jeremy, who is a careful scholar, who is not a unicorn. But I always took it as, I mean, I never bought that the Giza pyramids in Dashur were tombs, for the simple reason that there was no evidence that they ever were, and no inscriptions. And the whole inner structure of the tomb, so-called tombs of the pyramids, was wildly inconducive to any kind of a burial. These are different things. I mean, here are the so-called, I mean, they are the pyramid texts. They are really the pyramid texts. But they don't necessarily reflect burial exactly here. Here's the sarcophagus. I mean, that other sarcophagi, you know, inside nested. Later on, there would be seven coffins inside, one inside another, inside another, inside three more shrines, so that there were seven of them. Here, we don't know. I mean, but they have this giant thing that obviously was not come through and a passage we just walked down. But here, it's easily explained how they got it here, because this is not that very far. They would have dropped it down and then roofed it over. That, by the way, is subsidence. So no puzzle there. And the walls would have been entirely covered with hieroglyphs, as they are in the Unas pyramid, which supposedly, which has been shut to the public for over 20 years, used to be able to get into it. And now they say they're going to open it to the public again. On certain of the trips, when I have really high-end trips, with people with lots and lots of money, we can, you know, we could still get into Unas pyramid, but it was a lot of money. And usually the people, it's just a strange thing. Maybe it's cosmological, that the people with the most money are the ones who are least comprehending of what they're looking at when it comes to Egypt. Anyway, you could get in there. Now, until recently, so I don't know. So Nadler's book is complicated, but anyone willing, interested in pursuing it, as far as it can be pursued, is it's recommended reading, because I was pretty convinced that there isn't evidence, and that these are places of the highest initiation, and that the texts were meant for the pharaohs themselves, or for the highest level of initiated students to carry out the ultimate rites, which apparently often involve what they do in certain tribal societies, where the shaman goes into a state of suspended animation and gets literally entombed in a tomb, the tomb covered over him, and then X number of days later, the priests who've already passed the initiation lift the cover off, and if the shaman is still alive, or the apprentice shaman is now alive, he is now a shaman, and if he isn't, he's a dead apprentice shaman, and better luck next time. So whether or not that was actually what was carried out here, I do not know, and maybe no one can know. Meanwhile, the texts themselves are a scholar's nightmare that's only now maybe getting to the bottom of. And the reason is that this is Old Kingdom writing. Later on, in the New Kingdom and the Middle Kingdom, there'd be words that comprise four or five symbols. And then after the word, there would be what's called a determinative. If it was an idea or a concept, it would be a little papyrus scroll. If it referred to a plant, it would be a little plant. If it referred to an animal, it would be, it would have some animal determinative. So it told you that sequence of letters referred to that one of his meanings. And otherwise, there could be a lot of meanings for those three symbols. But here, there's no such thing, so you don't know where the words begin and where they end. And even if you did, if you were able to figure out, you might not know what they referred to. So When I wrote The Serpent, and I went to whatever, there were four or five, the scholars have devoted their whole lives to this since, let's say, 1850 or so, when the Hardy was, it was understood that Champollion had actually cracked the code, at least initially cracking the code, and the translations offered were so different from each other that it was hard to imagine that they were the same, based upon the same groups of, you know, of glyphs. Now, in the last 10 years or so, an Egyptologist called James Allen, who I think is getting, has got somewhere close. I'm not fit to judge, because I don't know. But there's a, let's say, there's a kind of an intuitive sense that these are, I mean, it's now sort of understood that, excuse me, that these are kind of manuals for getting through the underworld, and this is not hocus pocus, that it refers to a spiritual journey. So starting off from that point, there are some of the translations that seem to take that into consideration, and others that just regard it as hocus pocus and do translations as if that jumble represents the thinking pattern of the people that built all of this fabulous art, you know, fabulous architecture and did all of this fabulous art. So you take it as a given that it has to make sense, otherwise it would cause this trouble to do it. And Naylor, I think, is somewhere in the ballpark, and then recently in James Allen, and there's another recent book that makes a kind of sense. That woman, what's her name again? Something Morrow. Susan Bryn Morrow. Susan Bryn Morrow, her husband is a journalist involved in it, where she's seeing it as a very high form of poetry. I have the book written and actually haven't gotten around to reading it. She's on to something too. Anyway, this is a nightmarish job for the scholar. What happens subsequently is the New Kingdom and Middle Kingdom, they then come up with the system of determinatives, and so that's the kind of classical Egyptian. And then as time goes on in Ptolemaic times, it complexifies still further with all kinds of visual and verbal and sound puns, and it becomes more complicated again. And I use that as an analogy, roughly, that the pyramid texts are sort of like reading Chaucer. You barely know that it's English. In Middle and New Kingdom times, it's sort of like Victorian, you know, Saqqara and Dickens and Jane Austen and all of those good writers, where it's really, you know, it's basically literature and you can read it and enjoy it for what it is. And then when you get to Ptolemaic times, it's like Finnegan's Wake, if you've ever tried to battle your way through Joyce's Finnegan's Wake, where it's full of puns and all sorts of things. To me, I'm not a great Joyce fan. It's literary showing off. And it doesn't interest me that much. What?
Self-satisfied.
I'm not a great Joyce fan. But anyway, something of that sort. And in the Unisphere, and originally, here we see our starfish. Normally, when this is our second day, we see the starfish for the first time. That would have all been midnight blue and the starfish in gold. Everyone being the soul of a dead king. And the hieroglyphs themselves would have been midnight blue with the, I think in gold or in white, the actual glyphs left white. And one of the reasons they closed Unas was that thousands of people were going through there and the sweat and the breath was destroying the color. What they've done now, I don't know, I haven't been there since they reopened it to the public at some ferocious price, but somewhere along the line, someone good and rich will want to do it, and I'll get in there again. Or if we got our panel together of geologists, then they'll open it up for us. Actually, when we were here during the revolution, when we were the only tourists in Egypt, they were opening everything for us. They were just happy to have us here. All kinds of things were being opened for us. It was really cool. Okay, that's about it for here.
John, this is the pyramid text.
These are the pyramid texts, yes. And they are what the later funerary texts, the Book of the Caverns and the Book of the Gates and the Book of what is in the Dua, they're all derived from this.
From this.
And why they had to do that, I have no idea why they made still more complex. But it's the sort, it seems to be the normal course of development. And we talked about this a few times, of how a style starts off relatively simple and geometric, and then gradually becomes more complicated and more precisely executed to become still more complicated, and finally it's a big jumble and they start all over again. So, who knows?
John,
yes?
Have there been many samples taken of particulate matter inside of different sarcophagi to determine what may have been in there all those years ago?
I don't know. You would think that it would be something they would be rushing to do.
You think that if you found salts from deteriorated organic matter, or even you know, decomposed cotton or anything like that?
You should be able to tell a lot from that. And that's, I mean, Shock knows a lot about that sort of thing, but it's a good question. I don't know. I know they've done a few things on mummies and things of that nature. And, well, a couple of years ago found on mummies, late mummies, Ptolemaic, I think, or the maybe Roman era, where they found traces of cocaine in it. So, I mean, there's only one place where cocaine comes from, and that's South America. And they are, of course, the quackademics were shouting and screaming and saying it was a mistake and all the rest of it.
There are the top off of a sarcophagus.
What?
Yeah. That's how they carry the stones around.
Well, now that's as good reasoning as any. Whoa, geez,
there's other suggestive material that says that South America was like connected to here in some way.
There's a lot of stuff out there that there was intercourse between them. Book by back in the 70s by a guy with impeccable credentials within another field, and Barry Fell, called two books, one both bestsellers, one called America BC, where there are things, you know, Egyptian things 4 feet deep in a field in Indiana or something like that. Who put those there? And there's a Canadian tribe called Mi'kmaq that has a form of writing that seems to include a number of quite familiar Egyptian hieroglyphs. They invent them independently? Well, who knows? I don't know. But yeah, there's plenty. There's America BC and Saga America, and his fellow academics trashed him to death. And also he shows that there are lots of megalithic sites in America, and that's absolutely, you can't miss that.
Machu Picchu has similar stone construction to the temples that we've
seen. Well, similar enough so that it's hard to imagine them coming up with it completely independently. And the megalithic sites are rife in America. And, you know, there's no problem with them in England and Scotland and Wales and Norway. And they're BC for the most part. And in America, the idiots call them colonial root cellars. My sister had one of those in the property she owned in White Plains, in New York, or next door, the people at the house next door. And when you look at the way they were sited, this was on a cliff face, with big 3-4 ton stone blocks covering them, and the house was more than 100 yards away. So we're kind of colonial. There's 3 feet of snow there in the winter, and they're putting 3-ton blocks of stone to keep their potatoes, potatoes going, where they are living in wooden huts, barely able to keep themselves warm. But the potatoes are 200 feet away, perfectly secure, in a stone structure roofed by 3-ton slabs. These are fucking morons. And, you know, they to this day they They control, you know, their field, as it were. Naturally, now, you know, with the internet at our disposal, they can no longer shut this stuff up for generations upon generations, sometimes burying it. You know, it's always thought, I'll get into this, the idea whose time has come versus the idea whose time is not yet gone. Who knows what kind of great stuff really got buried for good, absolutely for good, when you look at things like Tesla and the Royal Life Microscope and stuff like that, and things of this nature. Only by luck did it survive, and suddenly 100 years later people recognize what great geniuses these guys were. Who knows what disappeared for good, because those of the academics put it to sleep. What?
Spooking me. Hassling us down. He was hassling us down in the basement for doing filming.
Yeah.
No, I stopped. You know, blocks of limestone, one after one, so that's the rough quality of it. And with just a little touch, sanding, you get to the better quality. Then it stages. Yellow?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, then here, look, there were like 6 or 7 groups of artists, levels or groups. And after building the tomb, and smoothing the rocks, the surface, they will come and paint. Look at this outline, right? And they do it in grids first. Look at the faint grid line, see? Vertical and horizontal. And then they copy what they have, the sketches that is approved already by the supreme artist, and they do it according to scale. So when you see, let's get back here, that's the scene, and this is half cut. Look at this, half cut, and then it's forgotten, or it's left as it is. So here is how they really take the walls from around, so the relief comes out. That's the main one. And then a finer artist will come and do just a little touch with hair, detail, eye, and nostrils and muscles. See the difference?
And actually, you notice this is high relief, so that's much more difficult. You have to carve the surface away, leaving the drawing that you're trying to arrive at, sort of emerging out of the stone. And what's remarkable is to see it in operation like this. We've seen it a couple of times, but not as clearly as this. The amount of detail and expression that they derive out of a, let's say the outline, that's about an eighth of an inch. And then you look at the musculature and the curvature of the papyrus stalks and the hand grip on the lotus bud. It's really amazing. And then of course they paint it, as you saw, inside. So this is pretty prodigious, and you have them starting, obviously, the skilled, well, let's say the finishing guys are starting from the middle and working this way, and the other starting guys are going that way, I'm pretty sure, and finishing up. I'm not sure if they're all finished at the end there. But you see, there is a method to it, and when Tal Tep dies, work stops. And why they did that exactly, I don't know.
Well, the tomb is shut, and it will be open until a second member of the family would use, because these are like a couple of rooms. And
some of them dedicated. Are.
Yes, here is Ptah Hatip
himself,
yes. Very highly Christian personnel for Unes, for Wenis, the fifth dynasty. This is his son. So you see his lock of hair.
And he's a boy.
Bird.
That's the hoopoe.
And John already explained that he was in the Sufi theater play.
In the play, and then, what is it, something? Atar el Adin, what is that?
Atar
el Adin el Atar, the 10th century Persian poet, I think.
Mm.
Yeah, and it was a beautiful, it was a great rendering of it theatrically, really good.
And this text here, it says that he's the praised one, worked for, actually, that's Titi too, he worked for two kings, and that's his name, P-T-H-P-T-A-H.
Hotep.
That's alone is Hotep, but they put the T and P for stressing on Tep.
Meaning the realization of Ptah, who is the architect of heaven and earth. So all of those Hoteps, all of those names, Ramesses, they all have
Hotep.
They all have a deeper meaning than that. Well, I mean, so do our names too, if you just go back to them.
And the grown up, when naked like this and you see genitals, so that's a slave. Other than that, it's covered, then it's a normal worker, or the baby also are in naked
mood. Adolescence.
And here, actually, is one of the most beautiful, although it isn't totally finished, but look at the posture of the ladies bringing the offerings and the goodness and the wealth to, with vegetables and fruits and animals to the tomb. Look at how each one has a different basket, you know? So if this would have been a great offering tomb, scene for women, if it was finished, still it is. This is very interesting. This here had the statue of Ptah Hatip, the owner of the tomb, and then we go to the master.
What was back there?
This must have been shut. Look, John.
What?
Maybe when we open we find something.
I don't know. Yeah, it does look like something sealed in there.
Maybe it was planned to be another room and changed for no more members. This was the sound room, and here is the tower.
Original, that ceiling.
Yeah. And
that's how it all would have been.
Oh, this is original.
This is original.
Yes. And that's how ceilings.
And they are actually in stone, but they replicate the still earlier ceilings that would have been palm logs.
Okay.
So, but I mean, this is going to a lot of trouble to capture a symbol that. You know, when it's palm logs, it's about the easiest way you can build a ceiling. You just back them up next to each other. When it's like this, that's a big job. You get to make the car for all of those things.
John was talking about the ceiling.
Well, we're just talking about the ceiling now. That's original. That's what all of the tombs would have had to begin with. And now come in here, and we'll start over here. And there's a sequence to these, but I, Ryan, or anyone else, as I know, knows exactly how the sequence was meant to be. But here, up here, you have Tal Tep himself, and you see that he's seated on a chair under which are his greyhounds and his monkey. Usual story he wanted to remember in the afterlife, his pet dogs and his pet monkey. Sometimes, though, you'll see a captured enemy under his seat, or sometimes if it's a woman, a lion. Well, I mean, did he want to remember his pet captive? I don't think so. What's symbolized here, we've seen this already at Edpu, basically seated on or standing on means master of. So here his greyhounds represent instinct under control. In ancient Egyptian, they're called Fesemu Heru, which means the greyhounds of Horus, or the hounds of Horus. And the monkey probably serves that same purpose as it does in India and China. It represents the chattering intellect, which also has to be under control. And here is Ptahuhep getting, doing his esoteric practice, John style. None of this starving in the desert and celibacy and all the rest of it. Here he is getting a kind of a foot massage, and here he's getting a manicure, and over here.
And here is a facial.
What?
A head. Massage.
I see that.
Yeah.
Facial, and over here are the musicians. Where are they?
Look at this one. Flute player, see?
Oh, yeah.
Flute player. And the singer, John. The flute player. Oh, yeah. Singer.
Singer, right.
There is a harpist. Look at the blind man playing the harp.
Yeah, the harpists here. Are often blind. It's a strange thing. Blind harpist. And it's funny, there's a poem of the blind harpist, which I think is, the Egyptologists only read on the literal level, but he's talking about the futility, the blind harpist is talking about the futility of the things of this life, and where are they now? They're in their pyramid. Well, he's blind, so he doesn't see beneath the surface of things. But interesting poem, I forget exactly where it's from. Now over here,
it starts from the top.
We start at the top, and why exactly start from the top? See, I can't see him.
Well, the blue here is the Nile, where lotuses are floating, right? And there are some guys up there gathering reeds and stuff. Where down below here, they use the reeds to doing those gift books, right?
Yeah. Again, transformational.
From
activity,
raw right? to manufacturing.
Now wait a second.
Here, the girls.
Oh yeah, wait, who's gonna?
The girls making some yoga.
They're doing kids' games, children's games,
okay.
Playing whirling around, and that was determined that they were, they're doing a kind of yoga or exercises.
Here.
And some of the games, I know that really one is supposed to be symbolizing
this
the four directions.
One of the
better Egyptologists figured that out.
Then here they're picking the grapes.
The vineyards.
And they're juicing it.
They're trampling the grapes.
And the bridge man here is squeezing the last drop of the flesh or the mist of the wine.
The must, as it's called, and that's a really vivid little scene there.
Yeah. Then here, John.
Now over here, these are the hunting scenes.
Yeah, look.
And here you see all of the animals of the desert.
Yeah.
And where are they actually?
Here, that's one. This one.
Oh no, there they're copulating.
And this one too.
And that's the Setian. That's the Setian force reproducing itself. Over here, down below, here they're hunting. Here you have the saying that's come down to this day, and here's a visual representation of it, of being scared shitless. They've got a bull tied and a lion savaging it. And there's a book about the sacred symbolism of ancient Greece by a French scholar who decodes the astrological symbolism of Greek vases. And there, it's a common scene of the lion savaging the bull, and he takes that to mean, I think probably correctly, summer the bull of Taurus being you know brought down by the
Leo.
By Leo the lion, and it is a male lion, and that's probably the case, but it may be processional. I'm not sure. I don't see where that would fit in here, but it could be somebody does a deeper study and finds that there is an overriding astronomical symbolism to this. Here you have a really good, here you have, well, that's down below, wait a second. Here you have really good representations of the greyhounds pulling down the various antelopes and gazelles of the desert. If I have a South African with me on the trip, they know instantly one's a gazelle and one's an ibu. Ibu? No.
Iris.
The what?
Iris.
No.
The eland, yeah. Elands and kudus was the one I was thinking of. What they are, which are not indigenous to Egypt. So maybe they brought them up specially, you know, to go hunting. I'm not sure.
Hedgehog.
But anyway, they're
with a scorpion.
You see the dog hunting, and that's exactly how they do it when they go after deer. When I got to Ibiza, the only thing left was rabbits. But they're exactly the same dogs, except now most of them don't have curly tails. They have straight greyhoundy tails. But sometimes they still come through with curly tails. Up here, I don't know what this is. It's a hedgehog. No.
Oh, here is the hedgehog. Right here, see?
A hedgehog.
With a scorpion in his.
Over the next one is a mongoose on this side here.
Right here is the mongoose here.
What's the next one?
That wild cat, I think. Look.
Maybe.
Yeah.
So,
anyway.
Don't know what that's. All of that has to do one way or another with the set aurist dichotomy. Over here, this is really interesting. These guys are building papyrus rafts, and it was pointed out by an Egyptologist who was also a doctor, who was the first one that noticed it, as far as I know, that many of these workers have not deformities, but have
hernia.
Yeah, they have hernias. They have something wrong. Hernias. They have swollen testicles. They have all kinds of things wrong with them that don't prevent them from working, but they're there. They have to be there for a reason. Yeah, there's an umbilical hernia. I have no idea why they were doing this, other than I'm just ballparking it now. Maybe it has to do with the papyrus as the symbol of the building, a craft that's going to take them through life. The papyrus itself is the symbol of northern Egypt for organic life. And so maybe they're showing that they're working their way through life and they have all of these, they're suffering from these various ailments, but nevertheless persisting in their, you know, in their professions. As I said, I'm ballparking it, but maybe this. Anyway, put it this way, it's not there just for the hell of it, because Ptahotep wanted to remember that all of his workmen had hernias and swollen testicles. Can't be that. It has to be something a bit more profound. Here, this is the best of the best, that I know anyway, of the hunting in the marshes. And here you have the guys, you have them sitting. One, two, it's funny though, they're different. There's one more. And here he's stretching the cord because the cotton net is filled up with birds. And so he gives the signal. Here, the guys are sitting here. They pull the signal, they pull back the cord and trap the birds. But there are more, there are more guys.
Sitting? No, there's seven, right?
Yeah, but here there are one, two, three, four, five, six guys. One guy has disappeared and said, oh, this, you can't do the work, I'm going to lunch. I don't know.
Yeah.
Again, there's a reason for it. Anyway, they're very vivid here. And here are the guys are playing. They are playing seriously macho games here, whacking each other with poles. And are the crocodiles down here? No, they're just having fun beating the shit out of each other.
Well, somebody here is top VIP having
And why very, and very, I mean, that really,
look,
this,
serious.
This is, you know.
That doesn't look like a game.
Well, it's it
like
is.
His pole is right through the chest of this guy over here.
No.
It does.
But he's still alive.
Yeah, I think you're right. It does look that way.
And they're only hitting each other on opposite boats, as it seems.
I don't know, but it's... Anyway, they're not fooling around, that's for sure. They would see, it's this sort of thing they were talking about before. The only thing that you have here explaining what that is that little bit of stuff there. So it would be a really interesting study, because these things are so vivid and they repeat themselves. And when are the hoopoe being offered here?
But do you notice? It's like levels in his life. Like that's him when he's younger. Look
yeah.
how he got older and more, like higher status, huh?
Yeah.
And now he has a high priest position.
Yeah. Now they're bringing animals. I can't see well enough to see those.
Here those.
But wrestlers who are with me say that those are absolutely standard wrestling scenes, wrestling holds to this day. Then they're bringing.
Animals
tribute, probably from Africa. Something that is a lion.
Yeah, cage. Where is the cage? Here. Look at the cages.
Yeah,
lion and tiger or some cheetah.
No, tiger, cheetah.
Cheetah. And here is more of the dogs.
More hunting.
Greyhound.
The greyhounds.
Yeah, and more gazelles and different antelopes. But
and
then here, show me this. This one, where? Oh, look at this one. It's hard. You can hardly see it, so you could take a look. The vet is kind of like giving some kind of painkiller or something to that cow, because she's delivering. Look, she's delivering a baby. Look at the calf coming out now. See, she has a baby.
Mm.
Delivering the baby. Then those huge fat
calves.
Well,
here, those are you know in the Bible. It talks about the fatted calf, and what's a fatted calf? That's a fatted calf, a force-fed, you know, force-fed steer. Those steer are both, I'm not sure. Anyway, down here, bird offerings. When I saw those at first, there's a study in there. That's the text on top. The numbers, why the birds are doing this, and sometimes they're looking backwards. This isn't just decoration. It feels like music, but I don't know if it is. It's a strange relief and a quite unique one. You see bird offerings later, often, but not
these are numbered. This is 100,000, that's 1,000,
right.
Those are 200. So each species is
know.
Kind of like we have this much of
more,
this kind,
more
this many of this
more
kind.
More interesting studies from somebody with the time to specialize in this.
The false doors are very special.
And these are the two different false doors. Certainly have different functions, which I don't know, but neither does anyone else. You're not missing anything. There's the color still intact, and if they wanted to restore it with the correct solvents, wouldn't take them that long and get the
shiny.
Really vivid. You know, well, we have seen it vivid in
Abydos.
No, not even in Abydos, yes, but in Deva Medina. Cenogem's tomb, where the colors were completely intact.
Cheetah skin.
After cheetah skin again.
No. Okay.
Cheetah skin costume of the high priest.
And he's holding the baguettes on the that's bread over the offering table.
It's said to be bread. I'm not sure I believe that.
It's written. Yes. And here are the ox. Each one is 1,000. 1,000 beer. 1,000 linen. You know, 1,000 of goose, goat. You know, thousands, look how much are there. But see, the most beautiful of all lotus and papyrus are right here. And this one too, I love this one. Very beautiful.
The colors still intact. What does it look like when it's all complete? Pretty spectacular. I'd rather not be buried, but if I was going to be buried, I wouldn't mind this.
In style.
Just not yet.
In style.
Okay, that's about it, or not of that.
What's this symbol down here?
Oh, that's the Hotep sign. Mm-hmm. The what looks like sort of like almost like a phallic, and be in keeping with offerings and realization of strange words begin like that. What do I think? Oh, I guess they put the guard around it so that people didn't walk over on it.
Yeah. What about that slot? Is there usually
that slot there, both sides. That's a curtain, right? That winds up and gives access to the outside. But you see, there's a whole study here. Why is the pole star like this with all of the writing and so on? That is absolutely geometric and clean and harkening back to the earlier time. There's a lot. Again, anybody interested in us, you Google up Talos app and see if anything comes up that's a full-blown study on this tomb. There probably is somewhere or another. And very often, those things are informative in the sense of they're doing this, they're doing that, and all the rest. And then you schwallerize it and you get to the inner meaning of it. Often you can do that, sometimes not. Often you do it. That's how Schwaller worked with himself, with lots of revelations in between, and that's how I worked with Schwaller.
Is it known for how long or why these areas of the tomb are sealed? If you're outside, you can see there's a big area over here that's sealed off. Every entrance is sealed off.
Oh, I have no idea. Sealed off probably modern, right?
It seems to be.
Yeah, they close it up so that people don't go in the
right.
Someone has some idea.
I'm finished.
I figured out for women anyway, because the women have a difficult time saying no when somebody's trying to sell them something. But there's a good solution. Imagine the guys are hitting on you and you don't want it. It's easy to get rid of them.
Yes, but if you want something considerate, they haven't seen brothels for a while.
Yeah.
You can consider the book if you did not get it from there. They have bookmarks and postcards. Anything? We may have them out buying a little gift to give away to anyone. Right.
As usual, we're actually sort of running out of time. But a lot of this we've covered at Hatshepsut's temple, the architecture, and the reproducing in stone at tremendous amount of energy goes into reproducing in stone what was easy in organic matter. These were, all of these crenellated walls were bundles of papyrus daubed with mud, and in between, mud adobe walled. And so it was very easy to construct, in a desert climate, really permanent structures. When you go, if we had a whole day to do Saqqara, we'd try and get permission to go to those earliest first and second dynasty tombs that are just mud brick. And it's surprising how well the mud brick has weathered over 5,000 years. But to do this in stone, and you look at the precision of the work, this is supposed to be the first major stone structure. It really doesn't look experimental, does it? I mean, it's incredibly refined. And people have done what the purpose of, purpose whatsoever. I mean, it's not meant as fortress walls guarding a military camp or anything like that. And so it's, again, 50 times as much work to do these with the recessed paneling, which is called recessed paneling. And this goes all the way around behind the Set pyramid there, and then this way, and then back this way. And there's been a study, an interesting study, somebody once sent me, I have it somewhere, but I just can't keep track of everything. But someone's finding that if you work it all the way around, that the number of these recessed things is somehow is astronomical. It's like 365 of them all the way around. And I would be willing to bet, if you took really precise measurements of everything and really went at it looking for mathematical relationships, you'd find all kinds of things, music and scales and things of that nature. Some of it, there's already enough of it so that you know it has those kinds of connotations. Now, when we go in, as I said, this is the basis of Bauhaus modern architecture. When we go through the first way, you see the stone, the palm logs and stone are the ceiling. And when we get in, on either side, you see these big, they're not single slabs, they're doorways, stone-thick doorways made of blocks of stone like these. But you see that they're meant to be doorways because, I mean, to symbolize doorways because they have hinges at the bottom and the top. So it's sort of John Wayne crashing through the stone, the barroom doors.
And so, of course, again, the wooden logs on top as a ceiling. And the bigger hall has missed ceiling, you know, the original one. So they replaced with this one. And it's a great op for you to take the whole colonnade with no other people but us, because it's the most amazing of all. This one, it's a great picture. Yeah, Reyes! I want him to disappear. Hena, look at this.
No one there. Yeah, this is a rare ability to get this with nobody in it. You all here? You see the double doors here on either side? With the hinges on the top,
yeah.
The hinges on the bottom, and the stone doors. The way John Wayne were here, he would go through into the bar. Now, actually, the significance of that is that they talk about the double doors to heaven. And again, it's another way of expressing the twin peaks of the horizon. It's with the solar disk in the center. It's one becoming two, the unmanifest becoming the manifest. And so with the double doors to heaven, that's, you know, unity dividing itself into polarity, into two. So this is, you know, this is the entry into the temple itself. And when you go down these extraordinary engaged columns, you get a sense of it. When I first came here, it felt like walking down, it was a musical sense of it, walking down as though I were in the inside of a three-dimensional guitar stem. And when I looked into it a bit further, the usual academics say that they did these engaged columns because they were unsure of the load-bearing capacity of the columns themselves, which is really fucking stupid. And all of that stuff on the top there now, that's all added on just for protection. At the very end, there was enough there so they could reconstruct what it would have been, which would have been the columns and niches between the columns. And when we get to the end ones there, you see, it's like my initial sort of intuition that's really pretty correct. Because when you get there and you have the end parts that have been completed, which they weren't when I started doing this, you're in a sound box. And if you do a chant in one of those things, even though it's not all complete, but if it were complete, you'd have a really resonant sound to it. And the columns themselves are called fasciculated. They're bundles of, symbolically, bundles of reeds. And so there are 17 on each of the columns, and at the end columns there are 19, and these are two very significant astronomical numbers referring to specific long-term cycles of the moon. And I mean, to do 17s, to cut two-thirds of a column into 17, and two-thirds of a column into 19 is not casually undertaken. I mean, it's easy enough to do into 4 or 6 or 12 or something with it. You do that with a crude compass. But to do it into 17 has to have some kind of a rationale behind it, and it has something to do with music. Supposedly the columns represent, or the niches represent, the various states of Egypt. They may or may not have had a statue in between each of them, but it's pretty powerful. And the suggestion is, it's almost grotto-free.
They'll be gone in a minute.
They'll be gone in a minute. But the suggestion is to go down in silence, quietly, ceremonially, and at the end, stop, and we'll do a little bit of a chant, or I will, in one of those sounding boxes, and you'll see what it must have been like when it was in full, when it was in full operation.
Entonces, él está viendo la forma como la construcción dentro de las casas, en el pueblo abajo, parecido un poquito como una forma rústica, porque ellos cuando utilizaron la naturaleza, traían, por ejemplo, el techo, la forma de
los hombres. Tell him he doesn't know what he's talking about, Carlos.
Well, he speaks very good Spanish.
John wants everyone to stop.
No, that's very worth it, because I think this whole thing had a musical significance. Here, you hear me talking in here now. And imagine if all of the whole rest of it were restored. So the ceiling over there, the inside is where you're all standing, is open to the sky. The other side is all roofed in. And it becomes, as I said, my original sense of being in the three-dimensional guitar stem is not far off. But you can hear, even this little bit down here, if I do a I mean, that resonates, and if they're coming through here playing all kinds of music as part of the opening of the procession or of the rites and ceremonies that are going on inside, that's gonna have some real power. So, you know, last word has by no means been said about the significance of this. That's interesting, Kyla. I will never remember it, but if you write it down and send it to me, I would like to have that, because that adds to the general overriding musical significance. We'll see more of it as we go through here. This whole complex has something very, very important to do with music.
Convictions, too? Did you
feel that?
What? The Ferrola? What? No, I'm going to say.
You want the pie necklace?
Let me show
one.
I'm interested to take a trip here with like three horn players.
Yeah.
Like a bass horn, a mid horn, and like a trombone, tuba, and triple.
Yeah.
And doing different places and establish what note resonates the best in each individual place.
Very interesting.
Figure out whatever note is the actual resonant tonic and then play the harmonies with it.
Yeah.
In each place and see how that.
You'd have to be careful about choosing the places that they, like, that were complete and not messed about with.
Bring a lot of bakshish.
No, that's the sort of thing that if you get a stage or two from where we are now, you know, somebody understanding that this is worth studying and and that it brings grockles to Egypt, it starts becoming feasible. What's not been feasible for the last 35 years suddenly gets easy, or relatively. So this is a good idea. Anyway, here, in more or less a little bit in the shade, this court is called the Hebsed Court. Hebsed means Festival of the Tail, and the academics acknowledge that they don't know why it's called that, but I'm pretty sure I know why it's called that. Originally, this is all covered with white limestone, the flooring. It's not sand, and it's a place where a ritual gets carried out called the Jubilee Festival, where every 30 years the reigning king, if he's managing to be reigning over there for 30 years, undergoes a series of mostly physical trials. And the idea is that it's to determine whether he's fit to keep on reigning. Apparently in Africa, but I don't know if this has anything to do with Egypt, they use it as a rationale. If he's not fit to keep on reigning, he's ritually put to death. They do this in certain African tribes. Whether or not that has anything to do with Egypt ever or earlier, I don't know. But this is a kind of a standard in academia that whenever they can find any excuse to denigrate the ceremonies or the real manifestations of the ancient Egyptians, if they have three different possible alternatives, they will always choose the stupidest one, or the one that makes them look the stupidest. This is a given. So in this case, it may not be that at all, according to Schwaller. In fact, it's a physical test, but its underlying significance is to test the initiatic state of the pharaoh himself, in which case he keeps on reigning. And what he has to do, this is all limestone, is that stripped naked, he has to run the, see out there, there's a little thing, looks like, you can't tell from here, but it looks like a B, the letter B made out of stone. He's supposed to go around the letter B, he's supposed to run around the perimeter of the walls, of the whole place, twice, and, you know, as a physical test. And that's no physical test. I mean, I could do that at 84. So the pharaoh reigned for 30 years and he took over the throne when he's 20. I mean, who couldn't do that? Anyway, probably because he's been taking care of all of his 60 wives all that time, so he didn't have much energy left. Anyway, he does that, and then there are a couple of other trials, and then he goes inside a festival hall there where we'll go, where there's some very interesting acoustical qualities to it. But meanwhile, in terms of Festival of the Tail, you've probably noticed many of the costumes of the pharaoh. He's wearing a bull's tail coming down from his ceremonial dress. On the walls there, you look over there, see the rearing cobras. the top of the frieze, and of course we've seen a jillion times the pharaoh with the rearing cobra at his third eye. So what this is, I mean, very familiar from Hindu practice. The kundalini rises from the tail and rises up the backbone and explodes in enlightenment in the third eye. So the festival of the tail seen that way makes perfect sense, and the evidence is all there for everyone to see. Pharaoh has a bull's tail, diadem is the third eye, and I mean, even an Egyptologist should be able to figure that out, but they haven't yet, so you got it from me. Other than that, anything else, Carla? What are you talking about?
Did we say about the pyramid itself?
About the pyramid itself, no, not yet. So you see them, when you get close to it, as I said, this is some of the sloppiest repair work I've ever seen.
It's a crime.
But the latest external face to it is not looking so bad.
Yeah.
It's the inner stuff, so it may be that a second application of casing stones. I don't see why they're doing it at all. It's not in any serious danger
some
of falling
money
down
on the side.
Who knows? Anyway, there's some really serious, interesting stuff going on up there. Some of it we will not be able to enter because they've got it fenced off. But let's wander up
let's
there.
Go
yes.
To the second
mountain. The festival.
Yeah.
All that. Urban Sakai. Okay, everyone, listen up. This is a John discovery. This is called the, what's it called for Haifa?
Festival Hall.
And these shrines are mostly reconstructed, and I'm not sure how many there were to begin with, but it's not the gnomes of Egypt. It's some regular number. Might be 10 for Horus. I'm not sure. Anyway, you see, when you go through, none of them are complete. But the originals, I think that one's probably at its original height. So they would have been sort of high like that, and they're like a little labyrinth, and with strange organic features, gates that don't open are part of them, and they take you around and around and around into those little niches. Each one has a little niche, and this is a John discovery in those little niches. And if there's no grockles around, and you listen, but you stick your head in there, and it's like holding a big, huge conch shell to your ear. You can, if you stay reasonably long, and there's no outside sound, usually you'll hear the pumps, the water pumps down in the valley, or buses or whatever, or the wind. But if it's really quiet, if you can hear your heart beating, there's a resonance to it that has to be deliberate. And the John theory is that the passageway in, which goes around in circles, is not in circles, but winds its way in, is meant to recreate the channels of your ear, without which you wouldn't get clear sound. I can't prove that, but when you get inside there, it seems hard to imagine that resonance isn't part of the plan, and that the way to achieve that resonance is to recreate in stone form the physical attributes of the ear. So go in and turn and take a little
put
bit of
put your
time
head in the niche.
Yeah, put your head in the niche.
Spot in with yeah. Your ear in. You can even try to record the speaker in to see.
Okay, I'll try.
But outside people will be totally silent. Please. Totally. We
Spanish friend and just tell her to reach rather than leave it.
I told her to watch your podcast Joe Rogan.
Which one? Which?
The latest one.
Which one? The Magical Egypt?
No, podcast of Joe Rogan, the show.
Oh, Joe Rogan, yeah, right.
I told her to watch The Mystery of the Sphinx.
Yes.
I told her to watch the videos.
Right.
And she told me she'll do them.
Right.
And she'll let me know when she has comments.
She what? She has?
When she will have comments.
Oh, okay.
But as she releases videos at least twice a week.
Uh-huh.
And the more I see her stuff.
Yeah.
I can see that it's going to be really hard to reach her.
Yes. Because
it's what she gets in university, and that's it. She only believes in what she can see and touch.
Listen, if you...
But I'll try.
Yeah. Well, you try, and then if it doesn't work, you give up. You don't waste time.
Oh, yeah. But as you said, I mean, they study so much that we can get at least half the work from them.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, if you have your wits about you, I mean, by the time you get to the fifth grade, you distrust school. What?
Behind the bars.
What?
Here.
Yeah, I know. See, Sahila? See if you can ask somebody what they're doing there, what they're pumping out. They've got those ventilating pumps going. And you know what, you should tell her,
yeah.
You should tell her to what, more, even more to the point, because you don't even have to understand anything, is watch The Mystery of the Sphinx, the Charlton Heston one.
Yep, at least that, and see
at
how...
At least that, and see what you get.
Okay. I will insist.
Okay, well, let's go.
Let's go.
Yeah, you get through
from,
here.
From that opening,
then. No, we can go right through here. Right.
Oh.
This did say no over here, though.
Did he say no?
Yeah.
It's not on
the who said no? Who said?
Can I go up on the scaffolding for a picture?
Yes.
Can I climb up for a picture?
No, but Dane can. He can climb up there for the top.
No, I can climb that. That's easy.
No.
He can.
Going up here, you can take a picture.
He can do the scaffolding.
Wait, can you ask
record.
You would say no, and I don't want you to do that. It's very dangerous. I have. Let's go. Making some restoration in the bathroom. Because there is ventilation here for that below the tomb.
Yeah, how deep?
They're cleaning up the corridors that have been full of
debris?
Rubble?
Yeah.
There are five levels below.
I was going to ask how many levels. Yeah, this is...
That's above, so below.
And you see?
What? It's a maze. 7 kilometers of corridors, maze.
Right. And this
That's why
is
it's closed.
Right. And ask them about the tomb. Ask him about there's a tomb, Shaila. I was here once. I was here once in the middle of the revolution itself, and there was an architect. There was an architect working here. What was
his
name? I forget.
Yusuf?
No, it's like a name of. Typically,
it
like Labib or something. Wasn't Labib, was something like that. Like Amir or something.
Amir?
I'm not sure, something like that. An old guy.
Ashraf Mustafa.
Maybe. A guy about my age.
Hassan Fahmy.
Maybe.
The big one.
No, maybe him.
Yeah, what about?
About my age. Well, because.
Hassan Fahmi.
Yeah, maybe.
I tried to
get in touch with him because he was telling me that they uncovered deep down. I thought it was a single block of stone, but a sarcophagus that weighed 170 tons. That was the sarcophagus to a queen.
He said there are three sarcophagus now.
Right, deep down.
Two in the fifth level.
Yeah. See, this is
alabaster, John.
Alabaster.
Ah.
This is there's stuff to come out of here. And you see where we're looking?
John, what? The kids are alabaster and Zoser is red granite.
Wow, but there was, according to the architect, one of these, this giant sarcophagus was to a queen.
It's okay. Unlikely to do
well, that's what
this
he said.
Many in one pyramid.
That's what he said, now, you know, we're not making this up. Anyway.
Yeah, but you see here, John will tell you in a bit, look at the blocks in the outside, that's the original. Why, and the core here is still original, but then there are some adds.
Yeah, this pyramid was definitely built, unlike the others, deliberately in stages of somebody changing his mind, presumably Imhotep, starting out as a normal mastaba and then becoming a square mastaba and then becoming a four-step pyramid, because you can see the interior casing blocks and then becoming a six-stage pyramid. And you see the problem with, whereas on the Great Pyramid and the other pyramids, each block rests on its own level platform, so there's no vertical thrust other than straight down. Here, on a batter, the thrust is going down like this, so any movement of the earth or any weak blocks at some point or another are going to crumble and they're going to take a lot of stuff down with them. So this is a very inferior way of putting up a pyramid. And they have the models in front of them all along. Anyway, you see down here where this huge pit is, and you see down below there, you see that's all bedrock, right? Or anyway, impacted Nile silt. And that's courses of rough stone. Those courses of rough stone go right down here, right through to, following me, and exactly on an east-west line. And, right, we will go there. How is it? Oh, over there. It goes over there. Up, we go up a little bit, and we come to a deep, deep, deep shaft in the stone. And you can see that the sides of the shaft are very deeply water weathered. And this is one of the most important pieces of evidence that we have for the whole water weathering hypothesis. So this is the thing that we want to really get into in depth when we get our geo panel together. And we now have at our disposal a friend of mine, I don't think you were on the trip with him, Carlos, Clay Roop, the baseball player, was he in the...
Yeah.
Clay.
Yeah.
He's buying, you know, our 10 acres that...
Yeah, so he told me.
And he's a very adventurous guy. And he bought himself a drone. So we now own a drone to go down into the thing and take pictures without us necessarily having to go down the steep ladder that they've got there, even if we could get permission. Well, we would, of course, we'd go in to look. So, anyway, that's as much as we need to, to get into here. And we'll go up to, it's a John Discovery, so they're named West's Wells. There are two of them. And actually, once we get up there, because I was, once here, there was an old Egyptologist, now gone, but who lived to be around 100, and he started excavations here, wasn't the first excavations, in 1925. And it was he who excavated, his name was Jean-Philippe Lauer. He who did a lot of the beginning restoration work and the excavating here. And up there, when you go see West Wells, you'll see, when you look in, it's deeply weathered. And at one point, he was not leading tours the way I do, you know, all day long, but taking people around. And I saw him there, and I said in my not very great French, if he had excavated this well. And he said, yes, he had. And then I said, did you ever notice the weathering of it? And he said, bah, I said, c'est l'érosion, c'est rien. It's nothing, it's weathering. And then he said, il y a un autre. And he pointed down, and sure enough, on the other side of the colonnade where we were walking, on a direct north-south line, there's another such weathered, deeply weathered well. But this is actually critical, because apart from Sphinx weathering and all the other things we've looked at, it's up to them to explain how in an arid climate, whether it's filled up with sand or not filled up with sand, how you get a deeply weathered wall of a deep shaft. This is a major mystery. Shock is, you know, is fascinated by it, and we'll see how it all falls out. Unfortunately, John? You can't get much photographically because you can't get close enough. It's sort of perilous to reach over the edge. If you had a stick, a long stick with a camera on it, you could probably get something, you know, dangling down, you could probably get something. We've tried, but we get something enough to show in the slide when I do a lecture. You get the idea for what we're doing.
Oh, he's got Mr. Ayman, the inspector, he's saying hello because we are with Quest. Ah. So he opened for the Sardab. You can go and see.
Hi, nice to meet you.
This side is also impacted silt or sand, and that is construction, and that is construction. They don't seem to have noticed that, but where is that leading? Leading into the deep shaft, the well, that I'll be showing you shortly. They ought to be. They have noticed that this is a big time anomaly, and this goes deep down, and when they get to the bottom of it, if they do, some bright spark. It cannot be Djoser and the Third Dynasty, that it has to come from earlier, part of an older construction. So,
let us go to the center.
It was hard. It was hard to hear you when you were speaking next to the machine.
Oh, right.
You can say that again or something.
I will actually. Maybe when we get up to West Weld.
Okay, because we couldn't get you there.
Okay, everybody. This is how it was found. This is original, or maybe it's reconstructed. Inside, looking out through the two holes, is the statue of Zoser himself. Actually, it's a replica. The original is in the Cairo Museum. But he's seated, and he's looking out to his destiny, actually, to the circumpolar stars. And they make a big fuss about this, and they opened it up for us to see this, which doesn't interest me that much. Much more interesting is the well. I'll explain. Carla said you couldn't really hear me when I was talking there, so I'll sort of repeat it when we get up to the actual West Well. But go look and see Zoser himself. Go ahead, David, take turns. And look at Zoser looking up at the circumpolar stars, which is his destiny. And in fact, all of our destiny. How he's supposed to see through both openings at the same time, I don't know. He's got a wide angle of vision, right? So this could reconstruct, you know, it's not that terrible looking, that's not bad.
Oh, maybe for different times, John?
What?
Yeah, the holes are there for different times of day or a month or a year.
Maybe, that could be. Well, the stars moved over the course of thousands of years.
Yeah, no, seriously. Someone re-drilled it, yeah.
انا ممكن اديك التليفون والتليفون
خمسه شارع الخطيب
مدينه مساحه حسن فهمي ده جاي
دكتور حسن
يا
Doctor.
Be careful. No. I tell them. What can I do? I've seen that 10 times. That stuff does some good. Your power.
Oh, yeah. I don't do it. Let's see, up here is probably better.
Up? This way.
Yeah, this is better. Are we here at the back? about 20 meters thick?
Hmm? What? You all here? Yeah. Okay, if you get where I am now, I mean, you can only pretty much do it one at a time. It's pretty slippery. You see that there's a neatly dry walling on that side of the well, which I believe is what we have on the other side there. So in other words, there's a passageway between this and that. There's an indication that it is, and on either side when we're over there, you see that it's just impacted, you know, that it's impacted sand, and then in between it's filled in with blocks of stone. And when you come here, you stand where I am, and you see that that goes down 20 feet or so, and then it hits bedrock, and then cut into the bedrock is this deep, deep, squared off shaft with its sides very, very deeply weathered. And the same in the other well, corresponding well on a north-south line on the other side of the colonnade. So this is serious, because when we're talking about, it's a Hila there, Ahmed Fahmy or something was the name of the chief architect who was working here when I was here during the revolution. And we got chatting. He was working on the things there, and we got talking. So Hila wasn't with us. One of the other guides, Emil, was with us. And we got talking to the architect, and at a certain point I asked him, because it was clear I was the leader of the group, if he was familiar with the theory of the water weathering of the Sphinx. And I said, and he said, yes, but I don't believe it. And I said, oh, okay, well then you come with me and let me show you something and you explain it to me. And so I came over here to the well and he looked in. And he's got very silent, and he said, okay, now, if this is not, how did this get weathered in from Zosa's time to now, when it's been covered up with sand most of that time, and there's no water around to have done that, and that is water weathering, according to my geologist colleagues. What do you say? And I was hoping that he'd take the ball and run with it, but he didn't. I wrote him, emailed him a few times. He didn't want to know. You know, he was about my age, and do I stir the pot up? If you get honey, there's still honey in the pot. I don't know. But anyway, this is a big deal, because when if we get the chance to present this again, we get the next chance to do the next stage of work, and we haven't. We have to get down in there, and it's now, who knows how much sand has covered up the original excavation. I don't even know how deep it's supposed to go. It probably goes about, my guess is about 25, 30 meters as it is. It probably goes deeper than that. Really, we have to get into it, Jacques and myself and maybe a couple of the other geologists, to really study it and be able to present it to another GSA meeting. But we're not far off, because there are a number of clinchers we've been looking at as we've been going along, and this is a major clincher. They have to be able to explain how this gets into this condition, especially when there are other shaft tombs around here that look as though they've been cut the day before yesterday. So go ahead, take it then, and really be careful. This is pretty sturdy in here.
So, this
what?
That's any indicator. No, that one came loose.
Yeah. Yeah, well, down below, this is known as the Tomb of the Unknown Grockle. See if you can stick that thing over far enough.
Will they let us climb down in there?
No.
One of us?
Absolutely, they will not. if you could sneak down in there, I'd have done it long ago.
Have you ever thought of throwing something that would make a sound? You'd at least know how.
Well, it's sand on the bottom, so it's not going to do anything. But if we get, if Clay has his drone,
yeah,
we can get here, totally, and put the drone down it. We can get some pretty interesting documentation that might lead to getting more stuff.
What if you dropped your phone down?
Well, that's what I was sort of thinking of, if you put like the selfie stick, if you had another extension to the selfie stick, but you won't get anything clear enough and definitive enough, I don't think.
No, but if you were to grab your phone and be like, oh shit, I dropped my phone.
Oh, well, I don't know. Don't throw it in. No, come on, Dave. No. Don't throw it down.
A video camera on a string.
What? Yeah, somehow. But of course, if you do that, then, you know.
Why won't they reopen the gate?
Why won't they what?
Reopen the gate?
Which gate? Well, I mean, they haven't. It hasn't occurred to them. I mean, they're not listening to anything that we say until or unless they're obliged to. That's how these things go, and no point getting frustrated about it. Because it's unmistakable when you look in there. Look at those. I mean,
how do you not get frustrated about it?
What? Because I don't allow myself to, because then they win. He who presses your buttons, you know, for whatever reason whatsoever, is your master. Very simple. Esoteric lesson 101. But it's quite clear that that's deeply, deeply embedded, and nothing is possibly calculated for it since the nasty times. And really,
recent.
I mean, when I talk about even old, because it doesn't look as though, you know, it wouldn't be subject to precipitation-induced weathering like the Sphinx, which is pretty explainable. Water rushes down the plateau and over the edge, and the Sphinx itself is less weathered, but it's still water coming from above over the body of the Sphinx. And here you have a hole. Is it going to, if it were completely full of water, it would get some, there would be some weathering because the water would react with the minerals in the surface of the stone, and you'd get some kind of weathering. But would you get that kind of weathering? And if you did, you know, would it be hundreds of thousands of years? I don't know. It's a, you know,
John,
I can't answer that.
Well, where do you see the weathering here precisely?
Well, right from the, you see, look below, get up to it, and you see that the big stones. The big stones, but below the big stones, you see very regular, very, very severe.
Oh, I
regular.
See it.
You see?
I see it, yeah.
It's a lot.
I got a picture here.
Hmm?
I'm gonna get a picture.